Very good evening all. Today we have a session on gearing up for GST professional by CA Jugal R. Doshi. He is very renowned professional speaker with the more than 50 plus session on GST at various platform. He is a chartered accountant, he is a company secretary, he is an all India ranker in CA. He has done many certification courses also, and also he has a speaker on various platform including big branches like Pune. So we welcome you, Mr. Jugal Doshi. Before we start the session, would like to Abhishek, see Abhishek Shah is our special appearance guest for today's session. He is a renowned chartered accountant from Navi Mumbai. He is a secretary at Navi Mumbai branch. He would like to address all of you. Abhishek, please continue.
So Virag, we should wait for 2-3 minutes. Means already only 43 members have joined only. Or we can continue.
We can continue. They will join in. They are already growing on. Around 50 now joined. We can start.
So we may wait for 5 minutes, na? Not?
Okay.
Around 50 members has joined.
Yeah, Abhishek, please continue.
Okay, so good evening, friends. So this is our fourth webinar program on this during the lockdown period of 21 days. So we have initiated a new thing that how can we utilize our time during this lockdown. So just to give you the background of me and Virag Shah, that we have created one Facebook as well as Telegram group on social media where we have connected around 15,000 professional all across India. Also we are having around 100 plus WhatsApp group. In 2014 Virag has started this thing, and now in 2020 we have almost connected 15,000 plus professional all across India. So our motto is to just share knowledge, updates, and any professional assignment within the professionals. So these are our mottos. So I request all the CA friends to please ask your CA friend to join our Telegram group as well as Facebook group. Also, you can follow me, Abhishek Shah, and Virag Shah on Facebook and Twitter. So we want to expand our next network so maximum people get benefits of this online free services. And also we are sharing various details, PPTs, files on our Facebook group as well as WhatsApp group. So I request all the members to please share our Telegram group to your CA friends. So now I request Jugal Bhai to please start the session because already 55 member has joined. Thank you, Virag.
Good evening, everyone. So first I would like to thank Abhishek ji and Virag ji. It's actually a very great thought. During the lockdown, I received a phone from him that as all members are going to be at home, let's do something productive. So as I was thinking which topic to take, so the basic I started was, let's start with what we can do in this lockdown period. So the three in my today's seminar, I have divided it into three main parts. First is about the audit report differences. As an auditor till now, what we have learned in GST is everything regarding the provisions of the GST, the legal side or many of the concerns which regarding to return filing or accounting. But what is our main task is audit. So in audit, what is the actual what should be our actual findings? How we should report them? That is going to be the first part. Second part is finalization of financials. So you all will agree that in last 2 years, what has happened is first my tax audit is done, my stat audit is done, and after that we have started with the GST audit. While the time we were doing the tax audit or we were doing the statutory audit, we have not thought what anything from GST audit point of view. So now what, as GST is progressed, it's almost 33 months which have been completed. So now it's required to take a holistic view that what all procedures, that what all things we should take care while finalizing our accounts right now itself, so that there are no queries while doing GST audit, and whatever errors are there, they get rectified in time. And the third part is what, how to make the best use of this COVID-19 season. So basically, for me, it is a blessing in disguise. What everyone, what is the day-to-day activities? If we see in office, in morning, when we go, we may be having work of only 1 or 2 hours in hand, but we don't know how our day ends. We are fully packed in complete execution thing. So now this is the time when we have thing. This is the time when we can increase the knowledge bank. This is the time when we can pre-plan things properly. So we should make proper use of it. So I have divided the seminar into three parts. Now we will start with to report differences identified in audit. So what are the types of audit queries? There are two types of audit queries. First is having financial impact and not having the financial impact. So what are the queries having financial impact? Whenever in GST audit, I will remove any tax payable. It is either going to be a difference in input tax which I have claimed, it will be a difference in output tax liability, or it will be a difference in RCM liability, output RCM liability, and it will be a difference in the interest working which has been done by clients or not. So basically, GST audit is nothing but, as we say in VAT audit, comparing in returns as filed by client versus returns as per us, as per the audited financial statements. So we have to make these differences. So how I have divided is GST audit from a CS point of view. There are financial impacts and non-financial impacts. For financial impacts in inputs, outputs, interest and RCM. And in non-financial impacts, they are either the observations or qualifications. Observations may be whether the client has maintained proper records or not. And qualifications may be some non-compliance, such as suppose client has not maintained the inventory records, client has not complied with 180 days provision, client has not complied with distinct entity provisions. So these things we divide into two parts. And next is financial impacts, means as per my audited books, input as per me is 2 crores, but as per 3B it is 2.10 crores. That is the difference in input. So in this input, there can be many reasons. Client has less claim, client has not shown the ineligible part, client has claimed of last year. So basically, we are not going to go what are the reasons of differences today. What we are going to go is, if I have identified this difference, how am I required to report this difference in my audit report? Now, specifically, I have created RCM as a separate tab. The reason is the treatment we give for RCM is separate as compared to output. For input, for me, it is same, whether it is a normal input or it is input on RCM transactions. But for output, I created two different parts, output other than RCM and output RCM. So now we will move to the first part, that is inputs. So what can be the findings? What are the different types of audit findings? As I told, as per my audited financials, the input is 2 crores. But in 3B, the input is 2.2 crores. That is, client has claimed excess input. Or in 3B, the input is 1.8 crores. Client has claimed less. So these are the two parts which can be there. In that, again, the types will be, now suppose, as we know the legal provision, for input, we are allowed to claim up to next year's September month return. So now 20 lakhs client has not claimed up to March 19. But what is required is whether client has claimed that ITC as on the date you are doing the audit. Now, first thing again, I would like to add over here is, I would strongly recommend that our GST audit working should happen before September end, or I would say before finalization of statutory or tax audit. Here, there are two parts. Doing audit is one thing, and if we want to add value to our clients. If we do our audit in time, there are going to be things, client has not paid the RCM liability. It is going to be the same output which I am going to give to client, but I give it to client in the month of August, my client would pay it and my client would claim it in the month of September. But if I do my work late, I claim it in the month, give this report to client in the month of November, the output liability is going to remain, but input set off time limit has expired. So we won't be able to take input set off. That will be an issue. So with this, my first point is what we should do in this 21 days lockdown is we can do our GST audit. There is no reason we should keep our GST audit pending. Means generally in Pune, when I'm talking with people, what I'm coming to know is, अच्छा हुआ मार्च में अप्रैल में अभी ज्यादा कोई काम का लोड नहीं है नॉट मच वर्कलोड नाउ बट आई डोंट नो व्हाई एवरीवन इज फॉरगेटिंग दैट जीएसटी ऑडिट इज ऑन द डेडलाइन फॉर जीएसटी ऑडिट इज ऑल्सो 30th जून एंड बेसिकली यू हैव द टाइम राइट नाउ टिल टुडे मीन्स वी शुड हैव फिनिश्ड एटलीस्ट 10-20% ऑफ आवर जीएसटी ऑडिट सो विद दैट पॉइंट ऑफ व्यू Timely reporting is very much required. So now in the case client, we are talking over here, client has excess claimed. Just a minute. So now in the case where client has excess claimed, there are again two probabilities. Client has reversed the same in next year or not reversed the same in next year. If client has reversed the same in next year, we will have to report it in table 12 of annual return. If client has not reversed the same in next year, then we have to get it reversed through DRC 03. Now again over here, what is important is we should examine whether they have actually reversed it in next year. It should not be just that, okay, any difference is there, feed the amount in table 12 and go ahead. Here we should actually verify whether the client has reversed this amount actually in next year or not, and if they have reversed in next year, then only we should report it in table 12. Otherwise we should report it in through DRC 03. Now the next part is there is less claimed. Less claimed means as per my 3B, ITC claimed is 1.5 crores or 1.8 crores, but as per GST, as per my audited financials, my ITC is 2 crores. In this case, client has less claimed the GST. In this case, again, there are two options. Client has claimed in next year, client has not claimed in next year. If client has claimed in next year, we will report it again in table 13 of annual return. If client has not claimed in next year, then as I told, we will see whether the time limit is available or over. Means we have identified this error before the due date of filing return of September, that is 20th October. Or after 20th October. If it is before 20th October, we have time, client will claim it in 3B, plus we will have to report it in table 13. If it is found after 20th October, in that case, it will be lapsed. So these are the possible things we will have to do. I am not covering this action required or okay thing right now. We'll come back to it later. First, we will see from the year of only the year I am doing the audit. Right now, the differences I am talking about is only for the current year. What would be the impacts of next year? We will look into it. So next part is output differences. Again, same in output, either client has excess reported output or client has less reported the output. If client has excess reported the output, means actual liability is 2 crores or 2.5 crores. But in my GSTR 3B, I have shown my output liability of 2.7 crores. Again, one more thing I would like to highlight over here is all the differences I am talking about are only with respect to GSTR 3B. Nowhere in my GST audit I compare as per GSTR 1 or as per 2A. Now in 1920, 2A part will come as rule 36.4 has came. But when we will talk about 1819 or 1718, 1819 specifically, there will be no role of GSTR 1 or 2A. My simple suggestion to clients is, what is as per audit, at the end of the year or up to the September month, you ensure that your entire GSTR 1 matches with your audited financial statements. Whatever amendments you have to do, you do it. You want to delete few bills, deletion facility is not there, you make it of 1 rupee. Amounts are wrong, change it. Classification is wrong, change it. Whatever you have to do, you do in GSTR 1. It is not to be reported in GST audit. What we should just ensure is my GSTR 1 cross tallies with my audited financials. Here, what we are discussing about is about 3B. So in 3B, if my output is excess reported, what I should see is whether it is reversed in next year or it is not reversed in next year. If it is reversed in next year, I have to show it in table 11 of annual return. Again, the question comes is, why it may be excess reported? Why will it happen? So there are many possibilities, such as, for example, client has later issued credit notes, but that credit notes client didn't reported in 3B. Original sales was reported at rupees 100, but later the price got reduced by rupees 20. So this 20 rupees credit note was not reported in 3B. 10 number of reasons can be. So today we are not digging it into why these four differences have occurred. What we are going to see is how we have to address these four issues. Now, if it is excess reported and it is not reversed in next year, means not reversed up to the date I am doing the audit. In this case, what we can do? In this case, again, I would say client will reverse it in 3B of the current month and we will have to report in table 11. So here, what we have to see is there is a time limit for issuance of credit note, which is September of next year. But suppose I have reported an excess sale bill and now I want to reverse the same. That is error in my 3B. So how should I reverse the 3B? Is there any time limit or no? So this remains a little bit, we can say a gray area. But it is my personal opinion that you should reverse it in current month 3B, because that is the only way right now, and proceed. So next part we go is in output, if it is less reported. If it is less reported and in next year client has reported the excess amount and paid tax on same, I would report it in table 10 of annual return. If client has not reported it at all till date, in this case here again people can say or one can have an opinion that this also you should report in 3B, but I personally would suggest to report it through DRC 03. Why? When we will come to next part of my session, wherein I would explain the impacts of last year audit or last year treatments on current year audit, that time it would be clear. So these are the main two parts, input differences and output differences. After these two parts, there are two small parts, that is difference in interest liability. So this one thing very important is, as an auditor, you are expected to calculate the interest and report whether interest has been calculated properly by the client and has paid the same. So interest liability, how will I ensure? How would I audit? What can be the reason? So the basic check or the basic tool for this is, if you should check whether client has paid any late fees. If client has paid any late fees, it may be 25 rupees, 50 rupees, 100 rupees, whatever it may be. It denotes that the 3B return has been filed late, and if in that return anything is paid through cash ledger, on that amount we have to charge interest. Now the law is clear. So whether this interest has been computed by the client and paid by the client. If client has not done it, it is the annual return. While filing the annual return, we report it in table 9E, or we won't report it in table 9E, we will directly report in 9C. And similarly for RCM liability. In RCM liability, here in input differences, I have mentioned including RCM inputs. Means the treatment for RCM inputs is same. But for output RCM liability, it is different. We all know there has been a circular by department where they have specifically told that if 17-18 RCM has been reported and paid in 18-19, it should not come in annual return of 17-18, it should come in annual return of 18-19. So now, and that has still been an ambiguous provision. So the basic one thing we should have take into care is we should not report RCM liability in table 10 or table 11. Table 10 or table 11 only specifies transactions in regards to supply. Why? There are five figures from annual return which are picked for audit report, and we cannot change that five figures. One of the figures is what is my output liability other than RCM, and how that output liability is calculated is table 9 plus 10 minus 11. So if I report my RCM in this table 10 or 11, it will come in my 9C as a part of normal supply other than RCM. So first thing which we should take care is we don't have to report additional RCM liability in table 10 or 11. There are two options. Either you report in table 4. When you report in table 4, what you should have to do is the gross amount of table 4 is to be shown in table 9. And then there will be difference in annual return in table 9 between amount payable and amount already paid. And that is the amount which we have, that is the additional liability generated by filing the annual return. Or you don't show at all in annual return and you show directly in your audit report and file DRC, pay it through DRC 03. So this is the basic summary of how differences identified in GST audit are to be reported as in our procedure of GST audit. So now this was okay for 17-18 being the first year of audit. Now the next question we are facing is, now we are in 18-19. How we should deal with the adjustments of 17-18 while doing the GST audit of 18-19. Also, I have seen many CAs have not yet started filing of GST audit of 18-19. The reason is they are not sure how they have to read these differences of 17-18. That is the main reason. Today, it's almost a month now that the 9C utility annual return has been opened, and you can successfully file GST on 9C. I myself filed more than 10 to 15 GST audits. So there is no error, starting everyone was saying GST 2A figures are not populated or something. But there are no obstacles, I would say, from government point of view. Now it is to us to determine what are the steps we are going to take. And by taking this is how I have decided my audit plan, and I am going to proceed. So the basic issues which we all are facing is in 17-18 there were many differences, and what we have shown is, for example, in input that we have reversed it in next year, that we have claimed it in next year. Now I am in my next year in 18-19. Now what I have to do about those differences? So my basic guidelines which I am using while doing GST audit is table 4, 5, 6, 7 and 8. These five tables will consist data only of my 18-19. Nowhere I would report my output liability or input liability, either reversal or excess reported of 17-18 in these four tables. Yes, there is going to be a difference. In my 3B of 18-19, my output liability shown was 2.7 crores, but in my table 4, I am showing it as 2.5 crores only. Why? The 20 lakhs which I have shown excess in 18-19 represents, I had shown less 20 lakhs in 17-18, that's why I have shown 20 lakhs more in 18-19. In my input, in my 3B, the input taken is only 1.8 crores, but I am in my table 6, I am going to show 2 crores. Why? The 20 lakhs I have reversed of regarding 17-18, not of 18-19. So because of this, what are the basic principles which we have to take care is table 4, table 5, table 6, table 7 and table 8. All these five tables are going to contain only my 18-19 transactions. I'm not going to report my single 17-18 transaction in these five tables. Now the main is going to be table 9. In my table 9, I have to fill the amount of ITC gross liability. The basic cross-check while filing annual return should be the table 9 amount payable and compared to amount paid. The amount payable which is editable by us should always be the total of table 4. Whatever is my gross total of table 4 including RCM should be there in table 9. Then there is going to be difference. As per my table 9, I have a gross output liability of 2.5 crores and tax bill of 2.7 crores through cash ledger or credit ledger. In table 9, there is going to be a difference of 20 lakhs. Yes, agreed. For that, I have my working, it represents 17-18 transactions. For input, there will be difference in table 6. As per 3B, amount is how much? 2 crores, 1.8 crores. As per my what I am feeding amount is 2 crores. There is going to be a difference of 20 lakhs. For that, yes, I have my answer. My answer is in these tables. Table 12 of annual return, table 13 of annual return, table 10 and table 11 of annual return. So what we should ensure is the difference which is seen is only the amount which we have reported in table 12 or table 13. The major risk which remains in this annual return and GST audit part is if there is any item of reconciliation in GST or 9C, it is taken care that the tax of it is paid through DRC03. But what is required is we have to compare even at the annual return stage. If at the annual return stage there is difference in my output tax liability as per 3B and as per annual return, if yes, whether I have paid it through DRC03 or not. If the input claimed in annual return is more or less as compared to 3B, if there is any difference, whether I have paid it through DRC03 or not. Even this should form part of our audit report. Otherwise, what would happen is a client have claimed excess 2.5 crores through 3B. In annual return, he will show only 2 crores. We will audit what we would say as per audited books, 2 crores. As per annual return, 2 crores. No difference. Everything is correct. But in fact, client has claimed 50 lakhs more. There is a wrong claiming of 50 lakhs ITC. If there is no control over here, the interest is going to be on with 18%. So that is also an important area. So the basic principle which we are going to follow while doing the audit of 18-19 is table 4, 5, 6, 7 and 8. They are not going to contain any 17-18 transactions. There is going to be a difference in table 9. The difference in table 9 would be divided into two parts. One is the difference because of current year. Why because of current year? As I told, suppose in respect of output, if it is excess reported or less reported and we are showing it in table 10 or table 11 of annual return, in that case, and if we are not showing it, then for example, this DRC03, this we are going to show it in table 4 of annual return. So this is going to be my one reason of difference in table 9, and my another reason of difference is going to be this table 11 and table 10. So how should I keep control in GST audit of 18-19 is that reasons for differences in table 9 should be current year DRC03 difference plus last year table 11 and table 10 difference which I have shown in my audit of last year. So it is going to be the net impact of these two things which will be there in my table 9. For input, it is going to be the difference basically as is shown in table 6, amount as per 3B and amount as claimed in audit. So the reason for that difference has to be last year actions only, and plus if any DRC03 is there. These two are going to be the reasons of differences. So with this, I think now there is some conceptual clarity on how we should proceed in audits of GST 18-19 with respect to amendments of 17-18. With this, we would move to our part 2. The part 2 of our seminar is question points while finalization. So what are the question points while finalizing or finalization? So basically it would play a main role from, suppose you are representing a company. I am accounts in charge of a company. These are going to be the points important for me, or these are going to be a points important for an accountant, or important for a CA who does tax audit, GST audit plus stat audit. Basically GST audit plus other audits. Why? The transactions or the issues which are going to be of specifically impacted by GST should be taken care while finalizing the accounts only, so that there are no adverse qualifications in GST. So the basic example is whether there are any inclusive sales entries. So now in last entire year when we were doing audits of 17-18, we as a firm, what is the issue we specifically found is, even in big companies, it becomes a very tedious job to set the exact procedure for small things. So now there is a company which is having a turnover of more than 1000 crores, or there are many companies. So they have all the systems and procedures set for the main items which contribute 99.99% of their turnover. But somewhere there are petty charges, such as some there is scrap sale. Somewhere there is weighing bridge charges. They have a factory, they have a weighing machine. Sometimes what happens is third parties come just for weighing their goods. So to maintain the relations or something, they allow. They take few income which is recorded as other income. It is collected in cash by the head in charge over there and deposited in monthly basis into company's account. No separate GST invoice is issued in respect of these transactions, as each transaction is say about 50 rupees, 30 rupees or something. But on totality basis, if you go, the amount is in lakhs rupees. GST is to be levied on these transactions. So inclusive sales entry is very much required. And it will have an impact on the true and fair view of financials also. If the amount is immaterial, then it won't be an issue. But if the amount is big, few of the clients are retail sweet shop or something, they have inclusive sales entries. All their sales are B2C customers, each customer bill being 50 rupees, 100 rupees. In that case, they are issuing a bill, and then at the day end, they are issuing one bill and they are doing accounting on inclusive sales basis. So whether this GST is separated or not, all these points we have already been following in VAT. The only thing is, when we have shifted from VAT to GST in this 1 or 2 years, somewhere or other, it is possibility that there is a break in this, because of which we are facing issues in GST audit. Second important part is discounts on purchases. These amounts being small have never been a typical point of issue from stat audit point of view or tax audit point of view. It is just a matter of representation, whether you show it as other income or whether you reduce it from purchase value. Why? Suppose, for example, in 50 crore, this amount will be 4 lakhs, 5 lakhs, not a big amount. But in GST audit, it becomes a pecuniary issue, because if you show it as other income, why GST has not been there on this amount? It becomes a very difficult task to explain it to the department official that, okay, this regards to purchase and it has been by mistakenly shown as other income. So other income has to be specifically looked into while finalizing the accounts, whether GST impact on it has been taken care of. The third point is, in all companies, all businesses, there are few charges levied as penalty in nature. What is required over here is, we have to examine what are the actual charges, whether they are actually penalty in nature, whether they would actually going to attract GST. Now, two examples which I have over here is, suppose in one case I have a contract with a person. I buy the goods from him at rupees 100. I'm using it them in my manufacturing line, typically in auto industries. They have limit that, so if your product fails, and because of that, we have not only lost the material, it is not only your material which has been bought is damaged, we have incurred overheads on it. We have put few other parts on it. We have incurred our labor cost on it. So if I would have bought the material at 100 from you, I am going to debit you rupees 150. We can't say that this is a sales return transaction. The goods are damaged. Are the goods going to go back physically to the vendor? No. And even if they go, can 100 rupees sales be returned at 150 rupees? So these transactions are penalty in nature. These transactions we cannot reduce from the purchase cost. On the other hand, I buy goods. What happens is, I am in Maharashtra right now. I buy goods from Madhya Pradesh. I buy goods from Uttarakhand. And it is promised that I will send you 16,000 kgs of the goods. But on receipt of goods, I found that these are 15,800 only. These are 15,800 only. There is a gap of 200. Maybe transportation loss. If there are food items, maybe transporter has taken it. We don't know what the situation is. So what we do is we pay less of 200 kgs. But while billing, it is done as penalty. Transporter payment 40,000, less penalty 5,000, paid 35,000. So here we are calling it as a penalty, but is it penalty? So these transactions has to be specifically looked into. The next point is recoveries from vendors or employees. Again, a good case over here to share with all of you. I have a client. It is not a legal responsibility, but they take some insurance of all their employees. They buy it in bulk and they recover the exact amount of insurance from the employees. So in this case, it is a pure agent service. There will be no GST on these transactions. So it should be set off against the purchase cost and not showed it in other income. On the other side, there is a client who recovers say 5,000 from their 100 vendors towards what? Towards some advertisement, towards some contribution for some fund or something. Say birthday advertisement. So we cannot say that this is in the nature of pure agent services. So we have to, and this cannot be reduced from the purchase cost. Or another example, I have taken 1 lakh from someone, given it ahead to someone. I received 12,000 interest. I have again paid 12,000 ahead. I cannot club this and show my expenditure as zero. In this case, we have to show income as 12,000, expense as 12,000. The next important point which comes is ineligible ITC on fixed assets. Talking on a logical level, it is very logical that it should also be capitalized. But on practical level, what we see is in the first year of audits, what has happened? We all were not so sure how to do all these reconciliations or something, or there was time paucity. What we have done is, as per my books, GST receivable is 12 lakhs. As per returns, it is 10 lakhs. So 2 lakhs, it is excess. Transfer to rates and taxes. A very big blunder. What is required is we have to identify the reasons why it is the difference. If there is ineligible ITC, if the ineligible ITC is in respect of fixed assets, it should be added in respective fixed assets. If it is a company you are providing depreciation on day basis, then this ineligible ITC, again, we cannot just show one entry on 31st March. We have to transfer to respective assets. If one of it is in April, then it has to go in April. The depreciation for it will be calculated from April. Next point, RCM applicability. A very important point. RCM is such an issue that there is a good phrase, stitch in time saves nine. There is no issue. I won't find any client who would be hesitating in compliance with RCM. Reason is set off is allowed. But what happens is, if it is not done on a timely basis, next year September the time limit for claiming set-off expires, but I have to pay the output. Now it becomes the cost. So this plays a very important role, and hence it is very important that any RCM applicability is to be checked on a timely basis, so that it is paid on timely basis and we can claim the set-off of the same. Also, another important thing is we have to check the genuine RCM applicability. What is the actual place of supply? Even in the reverse case, if RCM is not applicable but we paid the same, then also it is a risky thing. Why? Department can anytime take a stand that this is an excess payment of tax, hence you claim this as a refund and the input you have claimed is wrong. Now you reverse the input and pay interest on the same. So again, that can be a hardship and hence must be avoided. Many times the reasons for differences is late fees or interest. They are shown in GST or 3B, but not properly accounted in books of accounts. That should also be taken care. The next is impact of last year GST audit reco items. So while doing audit, all different types of errors have been noticed on few transactions. For example, bank had levied GST on bank processing charges, but client had transferred it to expense. In June, client came to know, okay, I have done this wrong. Bank had levied 10 lakh loan processing fees plus 1,80,000 GST. I should have recorded the only 10 lakhs as my expenditure, but I have recorded as 11,80,000. So now what client has done is, in 18-19, client has reversed that 1,80,000 as expense and claimed GST. Now it is a different thing whether what are the legal implications of these things. But what is important is this was your point of audit RICO, and now whether that entry has happened properly in books of accounts. While doing audit, we came to know on few goods, rate of interest, rate client had levied was 5%, actual was 12%. Client has bared this tax and paid while doing GST audit. But what is important is in next year, whether this has been transferred to cost or not. So that thing is very much required to be taken care. And to ensure all the above points, the very important thing is GST reconciliation. So what I personally feel is we should look into GST reconciliation or GST as good as bank. We all do bank accounting. We all have the basic concept that accounting is not complete unless our bank is tallied. Whatever reconciliation is there, reconciliation report should be prepared. So GST should also be considered at par with bank. You and I am having my cash ledger with GST. You and I am having my credit ledger with GST. There should be cash and credit ledger in my books of accounts. There should be monthly three entries. My three entries is one entries of the output I have reported, my liability which I have reported, the input I have claimed, and the tax payment I have made. Fourth entry would be the adjustment of tax payment against my liability. Every month in my books, these four entries should be there. The balance of electronic cash ledger and credit ledger as per online and as per my book should be tallied on a timely basis. If there are any differences, what generally happens is in my tally or in my any SAP or any software, there is a group duties and taxes. Below that, we have a group GST. In that GST group, we have subgroup output tax, subgroup input tax, and then subgroup payment. There should be another subgroup ledgers on portal. On monthly periodicity, whatever output I have been reported should be transferred from output group to monthly to ledgers, cash ledger, credit ledger. Input should be transferred, payment should be transferred. Then I should check whether there is any difference, whether there is any balance which is there in my output group now, there is any balance in my input group now. Logically, there should be no balance in my payments. Payment transactions cannot be in reconciliations. If there is an output balance of 2 lakhs in my output group, I should have bill wise details. So these are the 20 transactions which are not reported in 3B. I should have a plan of action, whether I have reported the same in next month or not. So there should be a complete GST reconciliation on the basis, and then only we should finalize our books of accounts. It plays a very important role because it shows what is the difference. From auditor point of view, if my cash ledger and credit ledger is showing 10 lakh balance debit, but total my group is 20 lakh credit, the difference is of 30 lakhs. What is the reason? Client is reporting output, not reporting output, claiming excess input. And if that is the case, on monthly basis, if there is any difference in output and input, whether interest liability working has been done or not. So all these things we should take care. Also, it should not be just cross-tied, okay, the difference is only 20,000 over. What we should see is whether it is exactly reported. Many a times, credit note, sales return. So in that month, there was no output sale only. So I have reported, I have shown it as an input in 3B. Sorry, that is not allowed. I deal only in Maharashtra. There was only one transaction. One output GST transaction, the liability was 5 lakhs. I paid 5 lakh output GST in a particular month. After 2 months, so few goods were returned. I had to give a credit note to my client. 80,000 was GST element in it. So now 3B is not taking the 80,000 negative. I cannot report it as an input. Sales credit note accounting is what we should examine. So this is a very important things which I feel we should take care while doing the finalization of accounts, so that these errors don't come at the stage of GST audit and we don't have to give qualifications over there. So basically, no one likes qualifications. No one likes qualifications. Qualifications should be there only when it is actually required. All the possible efforts, we should take care that we should avoid the qualifications. With this, we would move to the next part, is how to make the best out of COVID-19. If you have any questions, you can also post the same regarding, we can also address any of them about this part. So there is one question over here. Employee left early without serving notice period. So as an employer, we recover salary from employee for not serving. How this recovery should be seen considering GST, sir? GST is applicable on this transaction and we have to report the same. Discount received showing in credit side of profit and loss account having no GST effect. Treatment in annual return. So basically, discount received, if it is received on purchases, it should not form part of our annual return, because purchase credit notes are nowhere shown, and in finalization of accounts it should be reduced from purchase cost only. If it is on sales, in GST or 9C we have option credit notes without GST impact, we can report it over there. So now let's move on the next part. The main part is how can I make the most of my COVID-19 period. What all other parts which what all other things which we should do right now? We have always been running behind the deadlines, so this is the time to stop, to take a break, to look behind what we have done for the last 33 months, to revisit all the decisions we have taken. Believe me, somewhere or somewhat you may find yourself, okay, we are doing this in case of this client. What is the reason? Start questioning each and every stand you are taking. Start studying in each and everything. So this is the time when we can increase our professional what I would say is knowledge. It is very much required that we see ourselves. So basically what I have divided is there are three parts in what we can do right now. What are the three parts is first part what we can see is regarding my written work. So basically in GST as a CA, what all we do is we do into returns. We are there into GST audits. We are there into refund work. We are there into GST appeals. We do department GST audits. We do consultations. So let's start with each and every phase which we do and what are the pending things which we can do over there. There have been several changes in composition scheme recently. We should revisit whether any of our additional clients, any of our clients which are right now very normal scheme but are eligible for composition scheme. Maybe they were having a turnover of 4 crore, 5 crores earlier, but after their turnover has been reduced to 1 crore only. So now they are eligible for composition scheme. Composition scheme limit has increased. Earlier, there were a few services because of which they were not allowed, but now services are also there in the scheme. So these are the things somewhere on reviewing of something you would add value to a client. Also, CMP 03, CMP 04, ITC 04. These are the few returns which are mostly there is a tendency that we may skip these returns. Why? There is no cross check. If I don't file 3B of 1 month, I won't be able to file 3B of another month. If 2-3 months not done, e-way access will be blocked. Business may come to standstill. If GSTR 1 is not filed, my supplier won't see it is in GSTR 2A. He won't be able to take credit because of the 10% clause. He will come running to me. But what if I don't file ITC 04? There is no natural cross-check in this, and hence we should ensure that we revisit the applicability of these forms, these returns to our clients and whether we have filed the same or not. GST department audit season has already started, I would say. For 17-18, already I have done 4-5 GST assessments. So what is the person going to ask you in GST assessment? They have their standard checklist. These 25 details we require. So this is a time if you have access, what work we should give to a staff is you give this checklist to him, tell him to prepare all the points accordingly. Fourth is the return filing status. So one of the recent amendment was they have waived the GST R1 late fee for the month of March, April, May if they are filed up to 30th June. By this, government is telling that yes, we have not forgotten that there is a late fee on GST R1. They are not collecting it right now. But will it be our duty as a part of GST auditor that to see whether the client has not paid the GST late fee? There is a system of self-assessment. So return filing status can be checked. Refund applications. As per section 50, 2 years after the relevant date. Relevant date is the date of filing the return or in other cases, the date of export or something. For 17-18, March 18 or for the financial year, 31st March was the deadline. We are lucky that now it has got extended to 30th June. We should see whether any of our clients are having balance in credit ledger, whether they are eligible for GST refund. If yes, we have time right now. The entire application is online now. The procedure has become online. Circular 124, 135 which have been issued recently. Applicability of those circulars, applicability to our clients, whether we can do any refund applications. GST registration amendments. Generally, once client is registered, how frequently do we revisit whether there are any amendments required in GST registration process? I have changed my bank account. Two more directors have been added. Earlier, I had only 5 branches. In last 2 years, I have started 4 more branches. There has been a recent advance ruling judgment wherein the reason, one of the stand taken by department was, this place has not been declared by client as his place of business and is carrying out business from this place. So why should we not consider it an unaccounted business? We can't foresee right now what can be the implications. So it is better we see whether the registration amendments or anything is required. And this is the time we can cross check, as I told, to see back the 33 months, what are the pending things in our work, and to decide our future plan of action. This is regarding our work. Second is regarding our professional updation. So what is the status of GST right now? Circular, there are more than 136 circulars, 4 of IGST, more than 18 GST orders, 15 removal of difficulty orders, notification, if you count CGST, SGST, UTGST, IGST, they have crossed 1000. Removing duplicacy and everything, still there are more than 400-500 notifications. To revisit all the notifications which are applicable to our clients, the best tool which I feel is advance rulings. For advance rulings, you would see so which is the website from where we can see the advance rulings. We won't find it on gst.gov.in, we won't find it on cbic.gov.in. Advance rulings are, if we want to see any advance ruling, we have to go to GST Council website. There are more than, I would say, thousands of advance ruling right now. So this is the time, note down on your papers that what are the industries in which you are having the clients. Start with them at least first. Just go through the issues. All the advance ruling have the summaries. What was the question asked before the advance ruling authority? If any of the question is relevant to us, we should start reading it. So many points which we have not even thought of today, of the complexities of law, become open. Okay, government can think from this point of view also. Also, they are very good tool to understand a business. There are few advance rulings which are of 1 or 2 page. They have only analysis of legal side, but few advance ruling runs in 30 and 40 pages. There is a proper mentioning of the business activities which is done. Last week when I was reading, going through the advance rulings, I found one advance ruling in which the GST rate for around 100 products was clarified by the government. One sweet shop had given the advance ruling that I am selling gulab jamun, I am selling this thing, what should be the GST rates on same. There was an advance ruling about what to be done in case the goods are consumed at the same place or they are taken away, whether I would be a restaurant or not. We all have Natural's ice cream. There is such a wonderful case study of Natural's ice cream in the advance ruling, which completely explains the business model. So advance ruling is a I would say a great tool to increase our knowledge and to understand the way in which government is thinking, what can be the different point of view taken by a person, whether the decisions we are taking are really foolproof or there are any other way outs for that. Another important thing is product classification and rates. I have came across a situation wherein I have seen that in the particular industry, the GST rate is not determined by me. It is determined by my vendor. My vendor is an OEM. He says for this product 18% rate is there, I have to take 18%. But another OEM says the rate is 12% for the same thing. Or I am paying at 5%. But why 5%? Everyone is saying, I don't know actually the legal facts, whether it is definitely this same HSN. No one, we need not search for that HSN of milk. It is very easy. Everyone will know that is a clear thing. But if our client are having any of the complex issues, say flavor milk, in that case, it is a time we should research in which category exactly the goods fall and here. So these are the things of value addition which we can do sitting at home also. For us as professionals, what I personally believe is time is money. So a 15 days lockdown is lockdown from going from office, not a lockdown for our brains. It is just how we use our brains. It is just that, okay, this, now this is an obstacle in front of me, not this, this. We would work on another thing, but we have to do something. Another, we are very much lucky right now that government has postponed many new amendments. QR code, e-invoicing and new returns. They are actually the game changes which are going to be there in October. I don't know now because of COVID whether they get extension again, but they are the real game changes. So what is the new return? In this new return, what is going to happen is, right now I am claiming in 3B. In 3B I am claiming an input, but I am not giving any bill-wise details of this input. Output is not linked to my GSTR1. All these issues are going to go in the new return system. In my new return, there is going to be an annexure for input, annexure for output. On the basis of this annexure, the amounts are going to come in my main return. So all these loopholes are going to end. So is it going to be an easy task? Now we will have to require bill wise purchase register again. As an auditor, it is going to be a more difficult task to compute the interest liability. Today, what we go to is, for this month claimed is 40 lakhs, as per audit is 35 lakhs. On this 5 lakhs, we'll have to claim the interest. We have to see what are the different types of implications which will come. If there is any input, client can't bluntly say, sir, see, there is a 5 lakh excess claimed in month of July. So it is of 18-19 only. After this new return system, we will have to check bill wise whether it is actually claimed in 6 month returns of next year. Whether our accounting software system is updated for that. So in many of the cases also, one of the qualifications we see is, in case of small clients, they have thousands of goods. So their inventory accounting is never perfect. Say I am a distributor or I am a retailer of machinery spare parts. In my shop, there are 3000 different parts, 3000 different spare parts. It is very much required in the era of GST that we should be tech savvy, I would say, or we should have a great systems. How can we do GST audit of a person who is not maintaining inventory? The entire GST revolves around the inventory. How many goods are purchased, how many goods are sold, whether any goods are sold, destroyed or written off by way of free samples. If no inventory, that is going to be the first qualification which we have to come. In respect of e-invoicing, the e-invoicing schema which the government has given consists of, I guess, more than 100 parameters. There are various types of issues in e-invoicing. It is this time that we should go through all the things which are therein, I would say, on net about the e-invoicing right now. If you go through the list, there are more than 105 parameters that these are details are required for e-invoicing. One of the details which I find very odd is I also have to give the mode of payment. Suppose I am doing a bill of 2 lakhs right now, whether the amount has been received in advance or whether the amount is payable. For big clients, it is very easy. But if I am having a running account, bill to bill accounting becomes compulsory over here. So what all are the reporting requirements? What all we have to report? Means in invoicing, there is even a if your system permits, you can even give details up to the barcode level. Whether our system is there up to barcode level, to what level we have to report. There are few conditions, whether we are going able to fulfill those conditions. Say only 100 item lines can be there in one invoice. So if I am having a bulk sale in which there may be I am selling 200, 300 items at one time. So in that case, we should ensure that whether this condition is there or not, what all are the impacts on my softwares. So these are the new developments which are going to come, on which we can focus. Another important thing is the whether any training is required for our staff. We can even focus on that during these things. Prepare some notes, give them a few topics that we can work on this during this period. Everyone prepare on a topic and everyone will discuss. So something or somewhat we have to do. The only aim I feel we should do is we should make the best out of this. Now, if you have any questions, we would take the same. Abhishek ji.
Yes, Jugal bhai, I am there.
Yeah, actually I am not able to view questions, some issue over here. Can you?
2 minute, 1 minute mein ho jayega. I will launch just now launch one poll. क्वेश्चन आपको वो स्क्रैच करना पड़ेगा. देयर इज वन क्वेश्चन.
ओके,
कैन यू शेयर द चेकलिस्ट फॉर डिपार्टमेंट ऑडिट.
सो फॉर डिपार्टमेंट ऑडिट चेकलिस्ट बेसिकली व्हाट इज checklist means in starting when they start audit, they have a standard template that these all things you have to understand. So what you can do for this is they have came up with a manual. Department have the internal GST audit manual that the officers refer while doing the GST audit. It has the entire procedure, what all the officers are expected to do while doing the GST audit. What they have all their formats in it as well. So you can refer the same. I can also share the same to you. That is not an issue.
Yeah, one more question is that do we have to reverse GST on discounted received from creditor? Discount received from creditor.
Discount received from creditor.
Do we have, means it do is we have to reverse GST?
Hello.
Yeah.
So basically, it is on purchase. As discount is received on purchase in GST, the debit note or credit note is never issued by recipient. It is always issued by the supplier. So if the supplier issues it, then only we will take it into consideration. We cannot give for the same?
So more question is in the question form. Can you elaborate that slide? I mean that screen. Yeah, we will share the PPT. Few people are asking for PPT. I already posted in the handouts. You will get that. In case of business having medical store and he does not maintain stock statement and the same not reported in 3CD, how we have to report in GST or 9C?
So in this case, this was the exact case in which I was talking about. So if in one audit you are telling that you have not maintained the quantity records, in GST or 9C you cannot tell that, okay, I have obtained all the information required, or the dealer has maintained all the information which is required under the GST Act. So in this case, sure shot, there has to be a qualification that we would highlight you to the point number this in the tax wherein it has been told that client has not maintained the GST audit report. Client has not maintained the quantity report, and my GST audit is qualified in respect of the same. And hence I am not unable to view whether there are any goods which are destroyed or which are sold without consideration or something. So that qualification has to sure shot come.
So now you can view the question, or still not able to view?
I guess some setting has been changed. I'm only able to see it as a single line.
So there is only this question as of now. There is no more question as of now. Okay. If any question left unanswered, they can send again to, my mail ID. Or even you can share your mail ID, Jugal bhai.
Yes. So, thank you. Thank you for very much for your patient listening. If you have any issues, you can contact me on my mail ID and mobile number. I am sharing the same here with. Thank you very much.
And PPT is also shared, and we will one more time we'll share on email to all the attendees.
Yeah. Yes, sir.
Any question? Anybody has a raised hand? I think. Let me check. Now I unmuted all the participant. Can anybody want to ask? They can ask over the call. Hello.
Sir, I am seeing one of the question. ITC accumulated on fabric as on 31st July 2018 is still not reversed. There is a High Court judgment of Gujarat High Court. So are we required to reverse? So basically, here a legal interpretation will come. So one thing is there, if you have, at least we should ensure, if you're not reversing, we should ensure that that balance lies in my credit ledger. So tomorrow, if in it case we have to reverse it, at least we can take a stand that I have not utilized this for this period and hence interest should not be charged. What as per the government circular or that, then in that case, if it is not reversed as per July, we have to pay with interest. But if there is a stay of Gujarat High Court, in that case, at least we should ensure that there is a balance in our credit ledger so that we can avoid the interest liability. Next is sale in a month is lower than sale return. How do we report? So this issue, this is asked by Jay Kishan Punjabi, sir. So there is no way right now in 3B negative values are not accepted. And the only way is adjust against not if 1, 2, 3, 4, how many ever months returns it is there.
Unmuted all the participants. They can ask the question by unmuting themselves in the app.
Sir, in GST R 9 of 18-19, you mean to say there is a difference in table 4 and table 9 because of 17-18 adjustment? And we just have to keep it in our working and nowhere has to be disclosed. The question you have received is there will be difference in table 4 or table 9. So one thing in there is in table 9 of GSTR 9, there are two parts. One is the tax payable and tax paid. Tax paid part we cannot edit at all. the tax payable part has to be equal to the gross total as per table 4. So the gross total as per table 4 and the amount shown in table 9 should be same always. Then the difference which is going to be there is going to be there only in table 9, the tax payable and tax paid, and that difference is there, and for that the working is we will have. If because of that difference any tax is payable through DR03, we will pay the same. If the difference is because of last year, we will keep it in the working file only. That was the question asked by Kunal Shah. So the next question is by Prashant Agarwal, sir. Do we need to compulsory file annual return for the turnover below 5 crore? So after the recent amendment, what I would share what I am doing personally in my client's case is we are filing the annual return. The basic reason is if we don't file the annual return, what they are taking into consideration is the whatever original returns are filed are correct. So what I would say is as per the recent circulars in annual return, what are the difficult parts to fill? HSN, it is made optional now. Table 8 has been made optional now. So what remains is only table 4, 5, 6, 7, which are normal workings. These workings we have to do to ensure that whether there is under-reporting or over-reporting, because if not done now, it is not that the government is not going to take these cases for scrutiny. So if in that scrutiny or department audit, they identify the difference, the interest liability will increase till that time. There is a 5 years limit for selection. So instead of paying interest for such a huge period, it is good that we do it right now. And so according to me, it is not a great task to file a return, annual return, and hence we should file it. It is my personal opinion. Okay. So next question is by Anubhav Garg. In case assessee says credit is applicable, but the same is not carried forward in books and standing in e-credit ledger, whether liability of cess, if any, to be paid in cash or can be paid by cess credit. Is there any clarification in that? So actually, I have not understood this question and I would like more details on the same. Now one question is, what figures are to be shown in GST or 9 if difference in books of accounts and GST returns? So I guess I have covered it through my slides. If there is a difference in suppose output and input, if the difference is reported in next year, then I will show it in table 10 or table 11 or table 12 and 13 in case of inputs. And if the difference is not reversed or not reported in next year, in that case I will show them in table 4 only. Table 4 for output and table 6 for input. So the details I am going to fill in GSTR 9 are going to be, for output I would divide them into three parts. As per return, I would show in table 4. If they are not in return but shown in returns of next year, then I am going to report it in table 10. And if there is a difference which is not reported in 3B of next year also, then I am going to report it in table 4. Are we supposed to pay GST on bulk discount received from creditors? No, it is for purchase discounts. It is what we will do is we will account for as done by the supplier. We won't decide whether the GST is to be reversed or not. But we are not supposed to pay, that is for sure, because it is not our outward supply. Do we have to reverse GST on discount received from creditor again in this case also? Discount, if the supplier has not reversed the GST, we won't reverse the GST. So with this, I guess we have answered all the questions. I would let Abhishek ji and Virag ji take over now.
Yes. Thank you so much, Jugal ji. Wonderful session. We got wonderful feedback also on the poll, and many have already contributed in PM CARES Fund. That's all credit to you as a being a speaker. Thank you so much. We will end the session now. We have a tomorrow also session on emerging role as a CFO. So if possible, kindly attend that also, knowledge sharing session. Thank you so much all.
Yeah, thank you,
Jugal ji. I'm ending webinar now. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.